don't remember just for the sake of remembering. We need to have something in mind, the perspective, the use of remembrance. Remembrance, to some extent, is a sort of instrument. Secondly, remembrance is also a very selective exercise. The goal of remembrance, particularly today, is indeed to prevent genocide.
It is our collective duty to prevent the reemergence in Europe or anywhere in the world of such ideologies that point the finger at scapegoats, most of the times religious or ethnic minorities. Examples of the past have clearly shown that hate speech is often the first step to taking violent actions against marginalized minority groups. Wherever the situation exists where two or more people, two or more religions, two or more cultures are confronted, the only acceptable policy and relation is a policy and relation of compromise, acceptance and tolerance.
The defense of human rights is a value, is the value of the European Union. But it's not only a philosophical view, it's not only a philosophical objective, it's an interest. We have an interest to prevent mass atrocities, we have an interest to avoid genocide, we have an interest to defend human rights.
If genocide is a process that does not happen overnight, and if you can identify the risk factors associated with that process, you can therefore put in place measures to mitigate them.
Is law the right tool? Because these memorial laws are controversial, and then if their application kind of inhibit the possibility of historical freedom and of the freedom of research, then obviously that would be a problem. Except that when one has a look at the case law before French courts regarding the law prohibiting Holocaust denial, judges actually do not prevent historians from doing their jobs. What they do is they impose on historians obligation of professionalism and obligation that they shouldn't falsify history.
So since 2014, when we will introduce new program that follows after this, Europe for Citizens, so it will be the Europe for Citizens 2, we will increase the focus on remembrance activities. The budget for the activities will also increase, and we will also identify some of the key areas, one of them being the networking and the promotion of exchange of ideas on the remembrance and memory.
It's not only the memorial sites that we're talking about. We need to also already start, if we are serious about remembrance and Holocaust and human rights education at the same time, we have to start in schools. Obviously, there is some preparation needs to be made with the students and ideally a follow-up to the visit, because the objective of such exposure should not be to shock anyone. The objective should be to illustrate.
Over the last 10 years or so, Garivo, this Italian organization, has been promoting the idea and promoting its extension out of specifically the context of the Holocaust and the Jewish victims of the Holocaust to the other genocides and the other mass crimes. In this case, there is no need to restrict specifically to genocide.
I would say that the media do act as operationalizers, if I may say, of memory in a way. So they translate memory into something that becomes present, and this is done producing narratives. And even when we say that today's world is dominated by images, but I think it is important to stress that yes, it is true, images do worth a thousand words, but at the same time we do interpret images through pre-existing narratives.
The responsibility to stop mass atrocities under international law, but also as like a normative expression outside international law, is not new. But at least during the past two decades, since the genocide in Rwanda, there is a significant momentum of looking into the prevention of these particular crimes.
If we do want a clear culture, a true culture of human rights to flourish, then probably we need to counter these trends by increasing the attention paid to the righteous and to human rights defenders of the past, let's say, and to human rights defenders of the present.
Can European and other transnational laws against discrimination, hate crime, and genocidal denial or cross-civilization make a positive contribution, perhaps at symbolical as well as an enforcement levels?
There isn't good communication between human rights lawyers and human rights activists, who tend to take a fairly specific line on the nature of human rights, and international criminal lawyers. And one of the frustrations of working in this area is that many of the debates which form part of the discourse on incitement to genocide that we heard about earlier on, but also aiding and abetting genocide, the various lessons which have been generated in that debate are not communicated to the discourse of human rights.
At first, the whole process starts with very innocent things, that some citizens belonging to the majority, let's say so, of the population, says something something wrong, something damaging, hurting to another fellow citizen, which may belong to a minority. And then later on, that type of, and this is already a type of distinction between people. And that distinction might lead to criticism, sharp criticism, later on hate speech. And then it may then overstep a threshold that we ourselves do not notice, that we have already, we are already in the hate speech, in the worst case scenario, and we cannot keep it under control then.
From today's discussions, it seems to me that we have two broad kinds of approaches. One is at an individual level to encourage remembrance, right? So that the consequences of not protecting human beings and societies are very present in our minds as individuals and societies. And the other is to act at an institutional level through the design of appropriate laws. And it seems to me that again and again, throughout the various contributions, we hit against a problem that neither of these elements is, while both are necessary, neither of them is sufficient to guarantee the protection of human beings as individuals or as in groups.